wanna be somebody to someone. Oh, I never had nobody and no road home. I wanna be somebody to someone. And if the sun starts setting, the sky goes cold, and if the clouds get heavy and start to fall, I really need somebody to call my own. I wanna be somebody to someone. Someone to you. Someone to you. Someone, oh, I never had nobody and no road home. I wanna be somebody to someone. And if the sun starts setting, the sky goes cold, and if the clouds get heavy and start to fall, I really need somebody to call my own. I wanna be somebody to someone. Someone to you. Someone to you. Someone to you.
Hello and welcome to the second session of the 2022 Conference of the International Federation for the Aftercare of Racehorses, or IFAR, and it's my absolute pleasure to be your host for this session. My name is Caroline Searcy. I'm coming to you from Sydney in Australia, and I've been lucky enough to see the great work being done by IFAR even before its formation and in the ensuing years. The dedication and passion of people such as Di Arbuthnot, Diana Cooper, Elliot Forbes, Andrew Chesser, Jim Gagliano, and Dr. Paul Kahn is so important to not only this current generation of thoroughbreds, but for this wonderful breed for generations to come. As well as other hosting work in the Australian racing industry, I started my own TV program 3 years ago, Thoroughbreds Ago, which runs parallel to the ideals of IFAR to advocate for the lifetime care of retired racehorses, increase awareness within the racing community of this important responsibility, and increase, that's a big thunderclap, but we're still here, increase knowledge within the sport horse world about the versatility of the thoroughbred away from racing. I personally bred three thoroughbreds of my own. They've been rehomed. They've all come back to me. So I very much know the ins and outs of trying to find great homes for thoroughbreds off the track. It's not easy, but it can be made a lot easier for racing owners and breeders and the equestrian world to take these horses on. And they just have a great appetite for whatever you choose to get them to do in their new lives. A big thank you to some of the sponsors and the steering committee for this conference, in particular, the JRA, the Japanese Racing Association, and their Japanese Consultative Committee on the Aftercare of Racehorses. I hope many of you have already seen the first conference, which was held on May 5 and hosted so smoothly by Rishi Persad. It was really interesting. So make sure you have a look for that on the IFAR website if you haven't seen it already. The framework for the two conferences is, or the two sessions is, many paths, one goal. And in this session, we have some great speakers lined up. Coming up in the next 2 hours, we'll be hearing from world leaders on the topic of successful aftercare for racehorses and all thoroughbreds away from the racing and breeding industry. Speakers coming up tonight include owner and breeder Michael Drapak, Dr. Adrian Farrington, Executive Manager of Veterinary Clinical Services at the Hong Kong Jockey Club, Kirsten Green, Executive Director of the Retired Racehorse Project, Jen Hughes, General Manager of Equine Welfare for Racing Victoria. And I'm really looking forward to our panel of young professionals, or as Di called them last week or a couple of weeks ago, a panel of rising stars. They include Godolphin Flying Start trainees George Broughton and Eleanor Wolfe, former Flying Starter and now a trainer in the UK, Tom Ward, Caoimhe Doherty, who's co-founder of Troella in Ireland and stud manager at Fornart Stud, and Natasha Rose, Equestrian Affairs Project Manager and retired racehorse unit manager for the Hong Kong Jockey Club. So let's get underway, but don't forget there is a question and answer session in the last half hour. So please send in your questions throughout this session. You can use the Q&A button to send the questions in and we'll get as many as we can answered at the panel session in the last half hour of the conference. Firstly, though, I welcome to the conference Michael Drapak to talk on the most important metric determining the future of our industry. Michael's the founder of Drapak Capital Partners and a thoroughbred owner and breeder. He's won awards for sustainability and believes the goal of sustainability is more complex than simply painting the world green and requires an awareness of the full cost of a given endeavour through its life cycle, including the social, cultural and environmental costs. Over two decades, he's been vocal in the view that the most important metric to determine the future of the racing and breeding industry is how successful it is at repurposing and transitioning its thoroughbreds. Welcome to you, Michael.
Thanks, Carolyn. Welcome. So, look, it's very simple for me. I've been involved in thoroughbreds for a long time. And for me, before I answer this question or answer the key question for me is that we need to look at the future of the industry and how do we future-proof the industry? Who are the future participants going to be in the industry? And we look at Gen Z and we look at the millennials. And in order for us to really look in advance and see how our industry will shape up going forward, we need to look at what are their cultural values? How do the millennials and Gen Z view the world? And if you look at a lot of studies, in a very recent one was the Nielsen poll, and it showed that Gen Z and the millennials value social responsibility and environmental concerns above everything else. And so when you think about that, and you think that in addition to that they love animals, they're environmentalists, how do we shape up as an industry in their eyes? How are we positioned ourselves going forward? And this new world which we're facing, how do we think will be measured going forward? For me, it's very simple, is that we will be measured by how well we repurpose our horses, how well we provide humanely and ethically provide for them going forward. And I think that there was a recent report done by the Jockey Club about 3 years ago, and they said, I quote, to prosper horse racing needs comprehensive reform. And obviously that's why we're here today. But when I look at how are we doing, how well are we doing, I think there's a lot of room for improvement. I get very enthused by this conference. I get very enthused by what I see around the world and the initiatives which are being carried out. But I see a lot of gaps, and I see a lot of voiceless horses, I suppose. For me, every aspect of our industry, every aspect of the breeding and racing industry, must revisit what they do, and they must look at things through the lens of horses' welfare and their purpose beyond their productive racing career. And it's as simple as that. We've got to take that lens, look at it, and see how we could do things differently and better. And I ask the question, are we all listening? I know many of us are listening, but I look around me, I've repurposed about 20 odd horses of my own, and I've got about 25 horses at the moment. I see a lot of areas where they aren't listening. There's a lot of lip service, and I'll give you some good examples. But I'll start with the racing clubs in Australia. If you look at the mission statements of the racing clubs in Australia, nowhere is there a mention of welfare in their mission statements. If you look at the Hong Kong Jockey Club, no mention in its mission statement of welfare. There's no mention in their four core values of welfare. And I'm not being critical in the sense of we have to put in front of our minds the top of the page is that we will be judged by our commitment and our performance at repurposing our horses. And if you go into the Australian Stud Book, Carolyn, you'll see that their mission statement is to ensure the integrity of thoroughbred breeding in Australia. And they list six goals. Not one of those goals mentions welfare. So, and then I went recently to the English sales, and they did a great job, and there's some outstanding. The breeding industry is very robust at the moment. But you know what struck me? What really struck me? There was a massive lost opportunity there. There was $100 million changed hands for bloodstock, but there wasn't $1 committed to repurposing or well-being. And I just see this as a lost opportunity. It's just one of the gaps I see where we have this opportunity where there's hundreds of people, they're at their highest point of enthusiasm, they've got access to their checkbook, and we didn't capture $1 of that $100 million. We didn't capture the enthusiasm of any of the buyers. And I just see that as an example of where the industry, every aspect of the industry, what I said earlier, needs to look at everything through everything we do through this lens of repurposing, this lens of providing for the humane and providing for their welfare for the rest of their life. I read, going back to the Jockey Club report, the time has come for a new regulatory paradigm for horse racing in the USA, and that is based upon a renewed commitment to the horse. And that was written in 2019. It's inarguable. But for me, it's really about a commitment from womb to term for the horse. We need to look at every aspect of the horse's development. For me, the horse must be the hero. And I go back to the racing clubs and the Hong Kong Jockey Club and the Australian Stud Book. Welfare must be at the top of the page. Every responsible, progressive company in the world, and I'll use Patagonia as an example, their principal concern is the environment and their people. We must ensure that our principal concern always is our horses. So, of course, we can do it, but we're doing a lot of great things. I'm very buoyed by what I'm seeing, but can we do it better? I think we can. And rather than just going off on platitudes, I'd like to give some examples. The first tenet for me is there needs to be shared responsibility. Everyone that is a beneficiary of the horse racing industry has to carry their weight. We must stop passing the bill to the next person. Imagine if we lived in a world where the last employer was responsible for the superannuation, or the consumer was responsible for the ethical conduct of the manufacturers. We, every person in the chain of this industry, must share their responsibility for this objective, the repurposing and the lifelong care of the horse. So how does that look like, perhaps? Just to give you some ideas. The stallion, service provider, what's their contribution? You know, the stud farm that produces the foal, what's their contribution? They've got to contribute in some way. The mechanism, I'll come to a little bit later. The racehorse owner, and of course, the racing industry. But this shared responsibility is not just financial, it's also very philosophical in the way that it basically informs everything we do. If we take this lens and look at it, how would we wean a horse differently? How would we break a horse in differently? How would we spell a horse or integrate it into its training the sort of foundations it needs to ultimately repurpose? If every aspect of our industry and the horse's physical development and its training was looked at through that lens, I'm sure we'd do things a bit differently. I'm sure that we would break them in a little bit differently. I'm sure that we'd spell them differently. But no one is concerned with anything other than the immediate task in hand. So that's, for me, if that success, that metric is the most important metric of success and it's an enduring metric of success, it will inform what we do. The other point about it is that this commitment also starts with, at the very beginning, for everyone, for the breeders. For example, I'll give you an example of someone doesn't, no one's talking about this, but if you buy a brood mare, you decide to buy a brood mare to breed, you need to ask yourself the question, what is her retirement plan for when she finishes breeding or she has a premature end to her breeding because she doesn't make the grade? Soon as you buy a horse, whether it's a mare, whether it's a yearling, you must automatically assume, I am responsible for that horse. What happens if the yearling doesn't sell? What happens if the yearling is not conformed properly? What does the breeder do with it? Those responsible issues, they have to be factored into the financial modelling of owning a horse, of breeding a horse. And of course, the racehorse owner themselves, the racehorse owner needs to ask the question, when this horse retires, whether it comes to the end of a productive racing career or it didn't make the grade, how do I provide for its well-being post-racing? And everyone that's involved needs to start asking that question philosophically. It's an altruistic question. How do I, my mare doesn't make the grade, how do I provide for her post her racing? The mechanism, one of the things I'm very keen to explore, one of the things I think the industry needs to explore is to develop some sort of trust system. And I'm talking about a fiduciary trust or a superannuation fund. So could you imagine that if the horse is sold at English sales, that horse is sold with a trust account, which is specific to that horse. How would that look? If, for example, it could be established by the breeder. It could have been contributed to by the standing service fee provider. It could have been contributed to financially by the mare, the owner of the mare. And indeed, once the horse is sold, it's sold with this trust fund, which then the owners, the new racehorse owners, can contribute to. And even stretching a little bit further, it's quite possible it could be encouraged that the public could contribute. Can you imagine if a horse any champion horse had a trust fund attached to it, and you imagine the public are winning money, they could easily contribute to it. Of course, I've only touched on a few things. There are lots of other challenges for the industry. I mean, one of the things I think is really important is that when we register a horse, should we submit a retirement program? Should a person who registers a horse for breeding purposes or racing purposes, should they actually submit, I think the harness racing industry does it, some sort of program of how they propose to repurpose their horse or provide for its well-being beyond its productive racehorse life? And a question which comes up often is, and there's a lot of contention about this question, what's the optimal number of thoroughbreds which should be bred? For me, that's an easy answer. That the industry will sort itself out. The key point is that every thoroughbred should be properly provided for. Every thoroughbred, it should be guaranteed that every thoroughbred will be provided for its whole of life. So there needs to be reform in the industry to ensure that if a thoroughbred is registered, there is a mechanism there to provide for its long term, and it should be a shared responsibility. Breeders, and it brings me to my last couple of points, is that the breeding industry should, every aspect of the industry in Australia is licensed or regulated, whether you're a jockey, a trainer, a stable hand, or a vet or a farrier. I think a lot of our problems begin with certain breeders. The vast, vast majority of breeders are ethical, responsible, and do a great job. But I think the actions of an extreme minority tarnish the industry as a whole. We know the stories, and I think we really need to ask the question, should breeders be licensed and regulated more than they are? And the last point I'd like to make is the money is there. We know that the industry is about a $9 billion industry and employs 78,000 people. The cake is a big cake. Or if you do the math, it's not complicated. There is money there. If we were to take even 1%, like they do with Patagonia Foundation, if we were to take 1% of the money which is in the industry, that would provide for all the repurposing that's required. But that's being simplistic. But we need to have the appropriate reforms. And I think the money is there. But at the end of the day, our industry will live or die on one metric. And there won't be any, and it will be self-determined. If we can't meet the standards of socially responsible companies, we can't meet the standards of Gen Z and the millennials, our industry is going to continue to fade away, in my view. It's a great industry, but let's make our number one priority the well-being of our horses.
Thank you very much, Michael. Drapac, some great points there, and lots there for all tiers of the industry, from the breeders, the race clubs, owners, the public, to work on and see what real change can be adopted in Australia and around the world. Thank you very much for that, Michael. Our next speaker is someone I have a huge admiration for in her role as Equine Welfare Officer with Racing Victoria and as a member of Racing Victoria's Equine Welfare Advisory Council, and that is Jen Hughes. Jen's behind some extraordinarily successful programs that assist not only thoroughbreds in Victoria, but also those retraining them for a new life and those taking them on for competition or just as pleasure hacks. She has a master's degree in international animal welfare, and amongst many other roles, she spent 8 years with the British Horse Racing Authority. Her topic here is practical learnings from post-racing programs. Welcome to you, Jen Hughes.
Thanks very much, Caroline. Well, by way of an introduction, 2 years ago, I presented at the IFAR conference speaking about Racing Victoria's plans for post-racing. But that wasn't the start of our journey. In fact, as you can see from the second logo on this slide, the Off the Track program in Victoria is celebrating its 10th anniversary this year. So this all started long before I even set foot in the country. But when I spoke on this topic 2 years ago, we were undergoing a change of pace with a commitment of funding to accelerate our post-racing and traceability efforts. Today, as Caroline said, my presentation is titled Practical Learnings from Post-Racing Programs. And this is really important to me and something that I'm very passionate about, because it's integral to the success of our post-racing efforts that we're continuously learning from the horses that are coming through our programs. And that's what I want to share with you today. We were very fortunate to have a leg up over the first hurdle, i.e. funding, which has fast-tracked us into learning about the other challenges in this space. Now, I won't spend too long on this slide because many of you will have already seen it and probably more than once. But these are the aims of our post-racing framework, which dovetail with IFAR's toolkit and also support the theme of the conference, Many Paths, One Goal. We strongly believe there is no one solution and that the challenge of post-racing has to be addressed from a number of different angles. We use these aims to focus our efforts and our resources so that we know exactly why we're developing each program. And frankly, if it doesn't address one of these aims, then it's unlikely to make the cut. It's also worth calling out that these aims only relate to the efforts of horses' retirement from racing, but post-racing efforts has to start on day one, and this requires a whole of industry approach. These categories are fundamental to our post-racing plans, and 2 years on, we stand by them as a good representation of horses leaving the industry. What has changed is our view on the process for applying them. We had originally considered a formal upfront assessment, but in practice, the categories only really become relevant when a horse has struggled to transition. So therefore, these categories help us to have conversations about those horses' options. We found that it's mostly clear which category a horse is going to fit into, and then the eligibility process for each of our programs confirms it. The burden of providing the evidence to assess a horse's eligibility is shared between the responsible owner and Racing Victoria, and it depends on the program, but I'll talk a little bit more about that later. As you'll see, our efforts are focused on the category B to E horses, as those are the ones that need the most support. These are our vulnerable horses. They're at risk of poor welfare outcomes. Category B and C horses are only temporarily vulnerable, and with the right support, they can progress through the transition and have good welfare outcomes for the rest of their post-racing lives. Category D horses are likely to be vulnerable for the rest of their lives, and we need long-term solutions to support them. And our category E horses are already in a permanently poor welfare situation or highly likely to be dodging poor welfare outcomes for the rest of their lives. These categories are equally important when we reflect on the impacts of pre-enduring racing practices. What can we do to ensure the majority of horses retire from racing as a category A and B? So with that in mind, this is what our post-racing framework looks like today. You can see that we have our horse categories across the top and our post-racing aims down the left-hand side. Again, this framework is simply a tool to help us talk about the options for different horses and also to direct our efforts. The category A horses either transition without any assistance or via our network of acknowledged retrainers without any direct per horse support. We've currently got over 50 acknowledged retrainers who receive benefits, including promotion, support for horse acquisition, a monthly subsidy for each horse listed on our off the track community that helps with our traceability goals, and the opportunity to apply for our retrainer capacity expansion grant. And that grant has a total pool of $250,000 each year. So while that's not a small amount of money that's available, these retrainers aren't getting paid per horse. Our retrainers retrain approximately 600 horses each year, and currently there are 266 horses listed in retraining with them. Our support of the category A horses also extends to driving demand through our off-the-track events, of which there are approximately 200 a year. Our sponsor events have been around for a while. Our 10-year anniversary is this year. But over the last 2 years, we've been focusing our efforts on driving opportunities for less competitive off-the-track horses through our partnership with Riding for the Disabled Victoria, equine therapy opportunities, and our equine business grant program. These category A horses, as I've mentioned, are highly likely to end up in their new homes without any assistance from Racing Victoria, which means having an understanding of how many horses there are in this category can be really challenging. Therefore, incentivizing new owners to tell us what horses they have is a key objective of our off-the-track community platform. And I've got a little bit more on that later. You can see also from this diagram that the category and B and C horses, we have got one of our priority programs, Reset, and this supports their transition. The idea is that after assistance with a successful transition, they can also reap the benefits of off-the-track events and the community in the same way that a category A horse can. And the second of our priority programs was the on-site humane euthanasia program as the option for category E horses. And again, I have some more details about that shortly. Category D horses, the paddock sound only horses, continue to be our biggest challenge. We will shortly launch our Acknowledged Retirement Farms network and are working on some different ideas to incentivize people to take on these horses. But the main focus and the most important thing we can do for category D horses is look at our pre and post racing practices and ensure that as few horses as possible come out of racing as a category D. Now on to one of our flagship programs. The Reset program was launched in July 2020 as a transition support for category B horses. And the plan was and is to broaden to support category C horses. In this program, retraining with an acknowledged retrainer is funded by Racing Victoria while the owner retains responsibility for the horse. To be eligible, the horse must be bred in Victoria, raced in Victoria, or have been domiciled in Victoria for 6 months prior to nomination. They must also have had two genuine attempts to rehome, including one via our network of acknowledged retrainers, which involves being advertised to them for 10 days. If after that time the horse has not been taken on, they move to the vet assessment stage, which is funded and arranged by Racing Victoria. Our vets have the direction to assess whether the nominated horse is fit to enter retraining, which is a much lower bar than a pre-purchase exam. Since the launch of the program, we've also added two additional eligibility criteria, which will give a bit of an indication as to the horses being nominated. The first of the two new criteria is that the horse must have been broken in to be ridden, as we've had queries for some horses that have never entered training. That's our first challenge. The second of the new criteria is that the horse must be no older than 16. This is because we were receiving a number of queries in relation to older horses who had not been ridden for a number of years. And those that were accepted into the programme found the transition stressful and were unsuccessful in transitioning. RESET was developed as a transition programme, but what we've ended up with is a number of horses, some via the RSPCA, that after one or more post-racing transitions have ended up in the programme. And we also had an over-representation of retiring broodmares. You can see here from these numbers that 4 of the 44 horses accepted into the programme have been unsuccessful in transitioning and have been sent home to their owner. This was due to either behavioural or physical soundness issues. A further 4 horses had chronic soundness issues identified after a period of retraining, but we were able to find companion homes. Essentially, after a period of work, these horses were found to be category D. Of the 2 horses that were euthanized that you can see here, one was the result of an injury during retraining, which of course can't be avoided. And the other was due to a chronic soundness issue that only became apparent as the retraining progressed. So another learning that although a horse can be veterinary assessed sound at the beginning of the process, sometimes they don't stand up to the work. Next is a quick slide to give some examples of our successful graduates. You can see from these examples that 12 weeks is not a hard deadline for completing the retraining, and it's been more important to us that we find the horse the right home. What is absolutely clear from our successful graduates is that with a bit of time and effort, you can make a huge difference to a horse's post-racing prospects. So far, we have predominantly had category B horses through the programme, but we've had 2 horses requiring rehab that have provided us with learnings as we develop support for category C horses. After these 2 trials, our hopes are that the reset rested rehab will split financial responsibility 50-50 between the owner and the programme. Following a period of rest and or rehab, the horse may end up category A and not require funded retraining. Or if it does, it will be eligible for fully funded retraining via RESET. Now, our Off the Track community is a home for all of our post-racing programmes. And as horses access these programmes, we collect that information to get a better picture of our post-racing pathways. To complement this, we're also incentivising people to be part of the community and claim their OTT. The platform was launched in April 2021, and in the first 12 months, 2,271 horses have been claimed. This has enabled us to update the racing records for over 300 horses. And while this is not a positive indication of our racing records, it is great that we now have that information. Some other interesting insights that you can see are that the majority of claimed horses were between 5 and 9 years old, and 16% were 15 years or older, including a few in their 20s. The community is available to all Australian Off the Trackers, but incentives are Victorian based. We've had horses claimed in all Australian states, predominantly in Victoria, but almost 100 in New South Wales. We even have some Hong Kong horses claimed, and we share that information with the Jockey Club. One of the most important measures for me is the horses claimed in relation to their retirement from racing. Our aim is towards 100% of horses retiring from racing in Victoria claimed on the Off the Track community within 12 months. And with over 300 horses claimed after retiring in the current racing season, we're hopeful that we're going to hit that target in years to come. In addition to people claiming horses, the platform is open to members who do not have a horse to claim. We've had limited uptake from industry participants and racehorse owners, so this will be a focus for the future. In an ideal world, all racehorse owners and participants would be a part of the Off the Track community to follow their horses into their post-racing careers. And that brings me to our follow function. Owners of claimed horses can post pictures and updates, and their followers can see them. Followers can give these updates a carrot to show their appreciation. And as you can see, this function has been embraced by our Off the Track owners. And now we want to make sure that there are people on the community who can see these updates and engage with them. Followers can also see when a horse was last raced, was retired, when they have been claimed, and if they get a new full circle contact. The Full Circle is one of our key safety net programs where interested parties can nominate themselves as an emergency contact for a horse on the community. 900 horses have at least one full circle contact, and we're really pleased about that. I think it clearly demonstrates the responsibility that many racing owners, participants feel for their horses post-racing. So far, we haven't had to call any of the contacts, but the feedback is that people appreciate having the option. Our on-site humane euthanasia program is for the category E horses. It's not a program for acute issues, but you can see the criteria here on this slide. Since the launch of this program, we've had relatively small uptake, less than 40 horses. But from these horses, we're starting to get a bit of an insight. With such small numbers, it's not possible to draw meaningful conclusions, but each horse starts to add color to the picture of the post-racing challenge. You can see from the first chart that the majority of eligible horses had a vet cert for chronic injury or illness, and none were as a result of unsuccessful rehoming. The second chart indicates their entry to the program in relation to their last race. You can see that 41% had never raced. This is not as negative an indication as you may at first think. When you consider the majority of horses were ineligible due to chronic injury or illness, it's not surprising that they didn't enter racing and that euthanasia was the most responsible and best welfare outcome for these horses. So in summary, we've made significant progress in our post-racing options, but there's still plenty to do. It's been clear throughout this presentation that we have a clear focus for in the immediate future for transition options for our category C and D horses. And alongside this, longer term, we want to understand how we can reduce the numbers of horses that retire in these categories C, D, and E. We're also considering how we can provide support for the breeding industry who have their own specific needs for retiring breeding stock and any horses who have not yet started their education. Lastly, we need to keep learning and improving. As an industry, we need to lean into what the horses in our post-racing programs are telling us. What do they need from our programs? And also we need to ask ourselves what can be done pre and during racing to support our post-racing efforts. In keeping with the theme of the conference, there are many paths and one goal, but we all need to be pulling in the one direction.
Thank you very much, Jen. Some great programs already in place with Racing Victoria, some real results for so many thoroughbreds in Victoria. And I'm sure both yourself and Micah will have plenty of questions directed towards you at the end of the session. And don't forget, if you would like to ask any of our panelists a question, you can do so by entering the question on the Q&A function on your screen. Next, we're going to hear from Kirsten Green, who's been with the Retired Racehorse Project in the United States for 8 years, recently promoted to the role of executive director. Kirsten was responsible for writing the rule book for one of the world's great off-track thoroughbred competitions, the Thoroughbred Makeover Project. And I look forward to hearing more about the success of that incredible event as we hear from Kirsten. Her topic is marketing thoroughbred versatility, how the Retired Racehorse Project's Thoroughbred Makeover secures sustainable second career channels by putting the trainability and versatility of the breed in the spotlight. Before we get to Kirsten, let's have a look at this video.
The Retired Racehorse Project's Thoroughbred Makeover and National Symposium, presented by Thoroughbred Charities of America, has enthralled audiences and inspired thousands of equestrians to choose an ex-racehorse for their next mount. There's no other competition quite like it. Competitors get a maximum of 10 months to retrain a recently retired racehorse for one or two of 10 offered riding sports. Featured disciplines include what you might think of as typical for thoroughbreds, including eventing, field hunter, show hunter.
This horse is really nice. He's really leggy, and he truly looks the part of the hunter as well as moves that way.
Show jumping, polo, towards goal, looking for four, and Ben's got it. And dressage,
Lovely, lovely lengthening there. Nice light contact.
But also in the makeover lineup, showcasing the versatility of the Thoroughbred, are barrel racing, ranch work. I think we're going to get two ones in a row. Wow.
Wow, that was a great show right there.
Competitive trail and freestyle, where just about anything goes.
The Retired Racehorse Project was founded on the tenet that we can look to the market to create reliable and sustainable channels for horses to move on from their racing careers. 10 or more years ago, OTTBs were not being marketed in a way that shone a light on the athleticism and versatility of the breed, and so value and demand was so low. One of the key ways the RRP addresses this is to showcase these horses via the Thoroughbred Makeover.
With the addition in 2021 of the Jockey Club Thoroughbred Incentive Program's inaugural Barrel Racing Championship, and the addition in 2022 of a more comprehensive Western Championships, the racehorse and sport horse worlds can now appreciate more than ever that the Thoroughbred can excel at just about anything it's asked to do. The opportunities created by the Retired Racehorse Project to spotlight that Thoroughbred athleticism and versatility,
what a good boy,
have put center stage the talents inherent to the breed, and how the skills these horses already learn on the track build a foundation that will serve the horse for the rest of its life.
At first glance, the tests that we ask of these horses at the makeover after their first few months of training probably seem demanding, but when you consider all that they already know from their time at the track, coupled with talented riding, it's not at all surprising that they are able to achieve this level of development on this timeline. And then it's that much easier to appreciate the inherent trainability and professionalism of the breed. Each discipline at the makeover tests skills that are unique to the sport, but this is a retraining competition, so we also score fundamentals that are applicable to any discipline. Our judging rewards horses who demonstrate a desire to move freely forward, the ability to steer and stop with ease, a balanced canter on both leads, and adjustability of stride. We can say that the horses who carry the makeover graduate designation have received a solid training foundation that will serve them in whatever comes next, whether it's riding for sport or recreation.
A living testament to Thoroughbred versatility is 2017 Bay Gelding This Is Me, who showed at the 2021 Mega Makeover. He was bred and raced by RAH Bloodstock, RAH standing for the first names of Ryan Watson, Adolfo Martinez, and Heath Gunnison. After a five-race career from October 2019 to February 2020 in Indiana and Kentucky,
This Is Me to the inside end of fourth.
RAH Bloodstock transitioned This Is Me to life as a sport horse, and he made the Thoroughbred Makeover finale in both show hunter and ranch work with Gunnison in the saddle. While these are very different disciplines to behold, they're a great example of how the Thoroughbred can excel across a variety of equestrian sports and activities, sometimes even the same horse. With the makeover's national stage to display everything the Thoroughbred has to offer, the impact is profound. Not only do several hundred horses directly participate each year, but thousands of other equestrians who attend the event, watch the live stream, or follow on social media are inspired to seek out a Thoroughbred of their own for any number of sports and activities. To learn more about the Retired Racehorse Project and its programs, please visit www.therrp.org.
Good afternoon or good morning, depending on where you're joining from. Thank you for joining us today for this conference. I'm Kirsten Green, the Executive Director of Retired Racehorse Project, and I have a couple of follow-up slides to go with that lovely video that we just shared with you. The aftercare industry in the United States can be roughly categorized into about four different pillars, if you will. We have sanctuary programs, we have accredited nonprofit aftercare programs, whether they are track-based programs or listing services or facilities. We have the for-profit pillar of the industry, which are individuals who make a living, as commissioned listing agents or resellers. And then in the category that Retired Racehorse Project falls into, we consider to be incentive advocacy and education programs. Also under that umbrella, you could also classify the Jockey Club's Thoroughbred Incentive Program, NYRA's Take Two program. And With 15 to 20,000 horses retiring each year and approximately 25% of horses who are foaled not making a start, that is a significant number of horses that need to be placed into homes each year. And at its best, this industry is a holistic and codependent and collaborative approach. And the work of the incentive and advocacy and education programs is essential in support of the work that the organizations are doing that are actually housing and moving horses. The Retired Racehorse Project is the nonprofit program that is possibly best known for producing the Thoroughbred Makeover. Its mission is to facilitate placement of thoroughbred ex-racehorses in second careers by increasing demand for them in equestrian sports and serving the farms and programs that transition them. We try to make sure as an organization that our programming centers around three tenets, which are to inspire, serve, and educate. And the makeover is one of the key ways that we do that. We also happen to have a quarterly award-winning publication, a website full of educational tools and resources, but we are truly known for the Thoroughbred Makeover. The makeover fills a need to market these horses as choice breeds that can, as a choice breed that can be competitive against a warm blood or a quarter horse in whatever it is that we need from our riding partner, whether it's in a recreational or competitive capacity. And the RRP, or I'm sorry, the Thoroughbred Makeover fills those key tenets by serving. It establishes a first year goal for horses who have recently retired from racing. And that is key in driving demand for horses in the United States. The marketplace, which is also a component of the Thoroughbred Makeover, is a unique, one of its kind selling opportunity for people who need to place their horses when the Thoroughbred Makeover is over. And we do a lot in terms of print catalog and promotion to pull in shoppers and make it easy for people to come and browse horses that are available at the event. We also focus on education. People that are entered in the Thoroughbred Makeover can take advantage of community forum and resources from within a group that we run for past makeover trainers and current makeover trainers. There is education at the event itself, but also throughout the year, we organize several webinars with subject matter experts, and it could be on nutrition, training ideas, marketing your horse, or marketing your own business. But most importantly, the makeover fills the inspire piece by being able to join in the process, watch these horses over 10 months and see them come to the Kentucky Horse Park and be successful in transitioning into their next career. So how does it work? It starts with an application process for the participating person. We refer to those people as trainers, whether or not they're professionals. And that application process helps us determine that the applicant has the basic foundational tools and skills that they need to complete this process effectively. We want all kinds of people riding thoroughbreds, but this is also a showcase, and we need to make sure that the people that are bringing horses to this event have the ability to give those horses a good experience and present them in the best light. Once we accept those trainers into the competition, then they are invited to enter eligible horses, usually up to three. And the eligibility is a specific population that we're trying to serve. They're going to be horses that either had one start or one breeze and retired in the last 18 months and have not started retraining. But the most important part of this whole process is the marketing that the Retired Racehorse Project does. We have a robust marketing plan, telling the story and sharing the progress of these horses throughout the year. We want our following and our public to get invested in the success of these horses. We have constant social media sharing. We run several social media groups. We have blog partnerships for people who, like with America's Best Racing, will do regular blogging throughout the year. We do entry notifications to connections of horses that are entered and also send updates and information to the tracks that they raced at.
And of course, the marketplace that I mentioned is a huge part of our promotional plan leading into the event. We have a print catalog, a digital catalog, and every single one of those horses gets shared on social media leading into the event. The makeover is not a sanctioned event. We made that decision because it is a training competition. And so none of the disciplines follow exactly what you would expect from a sanctioned competition, or there are disciplines that are in the makeover that are not typically subjectively judged, that are competitive, polo, for example, or field hunters. And then obviously there's freestyle, where you can go into the arena and do pretty much whatever you want. So we want to make sure that the discipline formats are set up in such a way that they are testing some of those basic fundamentals. We know that horses who are well-trained, and ultimately if they are up for resale, that they are priced accordingly for the investment that's made in their training, are much less likely to fall into at-risk situations. Effective marketing increases demand and value. Marketing and demand and value are intricately linked. Driving demand is essential to moving horses efficiently and effectively through the programs that they're in, whether they are in nonprofit placement programs or if they're in a resale barn. There needs to be demand for the horses to move them quickly and effectively. As a sample population, we've been tracking the prices of horses immediately upon retirement and how much makeover trainers are paying to acquire them, whether they are adopting them through an aftercare facility or whether they are acquiring them like directly from track connections. And we can see that based on that population, the value of those horses has gone up about 50% since 2015, which is good. We are thrilled to see that. And I will just wrap up by pointing out that every image that is either in the video that we showed or in the presentation that I've made here today, these aren't stock images. These are all horses that have graduated from the Thoroughbred Makeover. Another couple of sample of horses here are also makeover graduates who have gone on to be ambassadors for the breed, whether they're moving up to the top tiers of their sport, serving their amateur or junior riders in whatever they would like to do, or just being a recreational partner. We have horses here that have moved up to play at the highest levels of polo, have moved up to the international levels of eventing and dressage and show jumping. We also have a great example of crossing discipline lines. And I think that's something that's so special about offering that marketplace component. Is that we see a lot of horses who are successful in one discipline and go home with somebody who's in a completely different discipline. The perfect example being the 2026 Ranch Work winner who went home with a Grand Prix dressage rider. This horse had a just beautiful movement. And then on the day-to-day, we also have graduates who are living out life, working at home, doing real live ranch work, or just again, working with their amateur owners to progress up the levels in their sport. So we are very proud of our makeover graduates and the impact that they are having here in the sport horse community in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kirsten Green. It really is incredible, the Equine Makeover Project. And I think some really interesting points you made there. Racing New South Wales being one organisation I'm sure will be interested as they set up their Equi Million based on a similar sort of strategy. So some interesting points about why it's about the horses coming straight off the track. I'm sure we'll talk further about that a bit later on. But thank you to Kirsten. Coming up now, we'll hear from another great speaker, Dr. Adrian Farrington, the Executive Manager of Veterinary Clinical Services with the Hong Kong Jockey Club. Adrian's been working with retired horses in Hong Kong for the past decade. And of course, Hong Kong has been one global jurisdiction with some really strong regulations about how thoroughbreds are moved to a new life with funding from their owners. Adrian specializes in rehabilitating thoroughbreds from injuries to enable them to have their best lives as sport horses. And he knows a bit about about elite sport horses as well, having been the team vet for Hong Kong's elite representative teams in eventing, dressage, para dressage, and he's also the FEI's head vet for Hong Kong. His topic is transitioning the retired racehorse veterinary support in Hong Kong. Welcome to you, Adrian.
Thank you, Caroline, for the kind introduction, and good evening from Hong Kong to wherever you may be in the world. I'd like to thank IFA for inviting me to speak, and also the Jockey Club and the wide-ranging team of my colleagues comprising of vets, farriers, equestrian managers and professionals across the Jockey Club, who for many years have been committed to finding as many second career outcomes as possible for retiring racehorses in Hong Kong. As Caroline has said, I've worked here for 10 years now as an equestrian veterinary surgeon, and the retired racehorse has been my number one customer and remains my number one customer. I'm fortunate to have witnessed the continuing evolution of our retired horse program over that time, with small changes across all stages of the process adding up to continual improvements in welfare and the quality of the horses that can be produced for a wide range of second career options. My talk today is going to be a brief overview of the transition out of racing for horses in Hong Kong, and we're not going to have time probably to delve deeply into data. So as a little background, the transition here of the retiring racehorse starts well before the date of their actual retirement. All the racing stables and associated professionals, including vets and farriers, operate under the auspices of the Hong Kong Jockey Club. And that allows us to have close oversight and centralized medical records of the health and welfare of all horses in training. It means we can deliver consistent education to stakeholders on best practices and on topics such as, you know, the one last race syndrome that speakers last week have alluded to, and Michael was alluding to continuing improvements throughout our processes. We can discuss that with our stakeholders, and ultimately, the aim is to identify horses with subtle performance limiting issues before they become irreversible changes at the time of retirement. Horses are imported as 2, 3, or 4 year olds with full veterinary background checks, and the majority originate from New Zealand, Australia, and Europe. Their median age is at retirement is 5.5 years, with compulsory retirement required aged 11, or should their rating fall below 25. Our owners are required to hold a permit to import a horse for racing, and they pay a fee at the time of importation into Hong Kong that will ultimately go toward the retirement costs of the horse. For permits issued this year, that fee is 100,000 Hong Kong dollars, which is equivalent to 12,500 US dollars. And then at the time of retirement, the owner may elect to privately export their horse, in which case they will receive a travel subsidy up to the value of that import fee they paid. Or they may elect to relinquish the horse to the Hong Kong Jockey Club for further management, in which case their import fee is placed toward the cost of rehabilitation and retraining of their horse with our equestrian affairs department. Currently, about 50% of horses retiring each season are privately exported, and around 50% are donated to the club for further assessment, rehabilitation, and rehoming. So for horses being donated to the club, we have a standard operations procedure on post-retirement assessment that is closely aligned with AAEP's guidelines on transitioning the racehorse. And a veterinarian will review the relevant clinical history and carry out a thorough clinical examination so as to assist in the effective planning, execution, and rehabilitation and retraining programs of these transitioning horses, and also identify and assess factors of a veterinary or behavioral nature that could prejudice the horse's suitability for inclusion in the program. At the initial stage of retirement, the horse's regular stable veterinarian can complete a transition prescription for any required ongoing medication or taper of current medication while highlighting areas of primary clinical concern for immediate attention. And a behavioral questionnaire is also completed by the trainer or his assistant, providing subjective observations with regards to the horse's temperament, trainability, and behavior within the racing environment. Now, while it is essential that the temperament of the horse is conducive to rehabilitation and retraining exercises in order for a successful outcome, many initial conflict behaviors can be improved with suitable rehabilitation, retraining, or relocation. And numerous tricky cases have been successfully rehabilitated through our training program or partner farms. With the medical health records and trainer reports reviewed, a standardized clinical examination is performed, with the findings being coalesced into one digital assessment report that will attach into the horse's online health card for the rest of its time in Hong Kong. This form will also generate a header with pertinent details regarding the horse, including the number of race starts, the number of barrier trials, and actually the cumulative fast work that horse has done as a racehorse, which can help us with our decision and planning. And this form will also track the ultimate outcome of the horse further down the line. The benefits of a thorough clinical examination at this stage are obviously manifest. To detect clinical signs of injury, disease, physical abnormality, and such. And particular attention is paid to the conditions commonly seen in the retiring racehorses. Of course, if conditions on the day of assessment in a busy track environment are not ideal, the horse can always be transferred up to one of our equestrian centers for further evaluation. Additionally, all of the horse's previous imaging records will be available for review. Although any clinical findings that cannot be fully explained on initial examination will be investigated further as appropriate, allowing us to properly diagnose, prognosticate, and formulate suitable rehab plans. We benefit from working closely with our club's farriers, and we have access to the club's advanced imaging equipment, including nucleus scintigraphy and MRI, often available at a cost price for transitioning racehorses if needed. We also have a project underway aiming to gastroscope horses shortly after retirement to assess their gastric health and ensure we target rehabilitation therapy in a holistic manner as well. At the end of the assessment process, the horses will be classified as to their expected future athletic capabilities. Similar to other speakers, these levels are also in alignment with AAEP's guidelines on transitioning the retired racehorse, and range from full athletic work with no exclusions at level 4 to pasture rest and non-ridden activities at level 1. In Hong Kong, rehoming options are most suited to level 3 and level 4 horses. So if we are diagnosing a horse at level 1 or 2, we will be communicating with our owners again regarding possible export or exploring other available options with partner farms overseas. Dr. Jeff Burke gave a talk last week covering euthanasia considerations. And based on the same AAEP guidelines, the club's position is closely aligned in situations where we cannot provide a quality life for a horse after retirement. So for horses that are accepted into the program, they often start their transition in Chungfa, in the Greater Bay Area of mainland China. The club opened Chungfa Racecourse in 2018, in addition to the Happy Valley and Sha Tin racecourses in Hong Kong, and it's a world-class facility from which our racehorses can train and race. Then, additionally, a retired horse unit was further opened here in 2020, and this has had the dual benefit of increasing our stable capacity for transitioning horses, while also allowing our horses to receive dedicated care from a specialist team in a purpose-built rehabilitation center, including access to aqua treadmills and spas so as to recover from acute stage injuries. Or they can just simply settle with a period of paddock rest in the fields up there. Once ready to start into more significant retraining exercises, the horse will transition to the equestrian center within Bees River Country Club, which has extensive facilities. And some of you may remember it is hosting the cross-country phase of the 2008 Olympics. And it's actually where I'm speaking to you from this evening. So once familiarized to their surroundings, the horses will start their schooling, building up their strength, suppleness, and balance through groundwork and then progressing into more ridden work. Through this process, we will continue to monitor and treat the horses as they rehabilitate from injury and strengthen further, or address any new performance limitations that may surface. Medical issues can and they do crop up, and often we will be supporting musculoskeletal injuries through the back and hind limbs of these horses as they transitioned into a more equestrian way of going. Weekly meetings are held with relevant key personnel to assess the ongoing cases and their progress and prognosis. And on average, the retraining process takes around 4 to 6 months in the absence of major setbacks, after which the horse is deemed ready for rehoming, subject to passing a final veterinary examination and the new home being deemed a suitable match. The same team of vets will then provide ongoing care and surveillance once the horses are rehomed within Hong Kong and also selected establishments within the Greater Bay Area, including the club's apprentice jockey school situated near Guangzhou. Many horses will be placed within jockey club or private riding schools where the horses provide a valuable resource to encourage equestrian interest within our community. And the more talented find their way into local amateur competition, often with junior riders. As a case example, this is Noble Boss jumping over the 120 Oxer here. He retired in 2007 and initially was a riding school horse in one of our public riding schools where his talent for jumping developed alongside one of our junior riders at the time. And she progressed to taking Nibbles on livery where they had a successful career together, winning many classes up to 125 and placing second in the FEI CSI One Star GP where he's pictured here at the age of 18. Now, of course, it doesn't always go according to plan in retraining and integral to the decision-making progress and decision-making process is continuous feedback and discussion between our vets and trainers, culminating in a formal monthly ridden assessment of these horses at Bees River. And that's attended by equestrian affairs management, our training teams, as well as the veterinary teams and future stakeholders. And during each assessment, the horses will be scored in four categories, namely flight instinct, trainability, movement, and jumping ability, allowing us to monitor their progress and identify potential strengths and weaknesses, adapting treatment and training plans as necessary. It also allows us to identify horses that we may not be able to match to a suitable second home in Hong Kong, those that are not suited to being regularly stabled here and maybe need a change of environment, or those that simply need a more extended period of rehabilitation to reach their full potential. To address these needs, the club commenced collaboration with Event Stars in Cambridge, New Zealand in 2014. And this has provided a valuable outlet to these horses and has produced some outstanding results, with the horses being rehomed through private sale. And there's a free return service for any horses that do not settle into their new homes there. And as an example, this is a great top light who retired in 2018, having raced 43 times. And he was subsequently exported to New Zealand in 2019 as we couldn't find him a suitable match to rehome here. And he was then rehomed with a young rider in Palmerston North the same year at the age of 9. Or alternatively, the horses can find alternative equestrian pursuits within which to shine. And here we have two horses retired in 2016 that went on to have successful showing careers. With great top light on the left here, winning Rising Star Hack in 2019, and Rad, aptly named Rad, finishing second in the Rising Star class at the Horse of the Year show the same year. So we're running out of time, but I'll finish with this slide of Pfizer Hill on the left, and actually at the front on the right here, who transitioned out of racing in 2004. He then spent over a decade on livery here at Bees River with my wife before she exported him for retirement in 2016. And behind him in the background on the right-hand side there is Noble Boss, who we saw jumping over that Oxa in the earlier slides, who followed his livery as she left for university in 2018. These horses are now 24 and 22 respectively. And having lived a pretty fulfilling second career life, they're now enjoying a well-earned retirement on the hills below Oxford in the UK. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that, Adrian Farrington. Some really good insight into the way Hong Kong and the Hong Kong Jockey Club work. And it's been great to see so many of these horses. I've seen a lot of them around in Australia, and I've seen them in New Zealand as well, that actually do get back to whether it be their place of birth or just finding new homes to be retrained for. So it really is a fantastic system. All right, something I've been looking forward to heading into this second session of the 2022 IFAR conference is the Young Professionals panel, made up of some Godolphin Flying Start students and graduates and more. And while we can see so much work being done around the world to bring about better outcomes for thoroughbreds away from racing, the job of even further improving the welfare puzzle will fall on the next generation of industry leaders. And the IFAR committee has certainly pulled together some great young minds for this panel discussion. Titled Future Telling, Thoroughbred Aftercare in 2042. Before we start the panel, let's just see firstly some of the great work being done in Ireland by Troella.
Hello and welcome to the JAG Equestrian Centre here in County Kildare for the inaugural Troella Racehorse to Riding Horse class, which is really the brainchild of Caoimhe Doherty and Sarah Sands. Great night ahead, Kevin, really looking forward to it, and it's great to see some of the former champions of the race course having to turn their attention to something a little different.
Yes, this is a wonderful initiative. Troella was only formed, of course, in February of this year as well. It's come a long way in a very short period of time, and the idea behind tonight's event is to kind of showcase it to the wider public and all that. We've got all the stars from top jockeys, former top jockeys in Paul Carberry, Katie Walsh, we've got Davy Russell, we've got all the Mullins lads, David Mullins, Danny Mullins, Patrick Mullins, we've got some of former and current top event riders and show jump riders as well, Sam Watkins, Cahill Daniels, Sarah Wardell, and I think what's a great touch as well is all the kids are involved as well. In the four member team, of course, each team of four will have a child riding their pony as well, and we've got some of the real exciting new, the up and coming kids, the likes of the Ben Connors, Isabel Walsh, Lucy McCarthy, Georgina De Bra, Head, Olivia Swan, obviously very accomplished as well, and Claire Farrell as well. So I think it's a great mix. I'm really looking forward to it. Everybody is rode in together. It nearly didn't happen, as we all know. It was due to be held in Emerald until yesterday evening, and obviously fair play to the team here at JAG. They took it on, and everybody's been working tirelessly through the night and through the afternoon. And as I said, there's a big turnout, which is great to see, and I think this is the start of something that's going to get very big.
Some great vision and great work being done by Troella in Ireland, and introducing the Young Professionals panel for you. Caoimhe Doherty is a co-founder of Troella, a not-for-profit organisation promoting thoroughbreds in a second career. Natasha Rose is Equestrian Affairs Project Manager and retired horse unit manager for the Hong Kong Jockey Club. George Broughton is a current trainee in the Godolphin Flying Start program. He's worked for trainers Gay Waterhouse and Adrian Bott and Richard and Michael Friedman in Australia, along with New Zealand Bloodstock and Tween Hill Stud in the UK. Eleanor Wolfe is also a current Flying Start trainee from Kentucky and has already graduated from the Irish National Stud Program. And Tom Ward is now a trainer in his own right in the UK. He previously worked with leading trainers Richard Hannon and Mark Johnson in England, the likes of Alain de Roy Dupre in France, and spent time working for Godolphin and John O'Shea in Australia. So I'll start with you, Caoimhe. You've obviously had great success with Troela. You have wonderful prize money starting to grow for off-track thoroughbred competitions in Ireland. You've set up a portal for people trying to find thoroughbreds to take on away from racing. And you have three main aims, as you state them, to support, to connect and to promote. What do you think are the best ways to be able to tell the story of the thoroughbred to future generations and promote them as being a great riding horse, fending off those who believe we can never do enough for our thoroughbreds?
Yeah, as you said, Troela, we only started, we're just a year in existence now, and it was all about connecting, supporting and promoting. And I think what you've really touched there is the promote. We have to promote the horse, you know, the versatility. We've just seen fantastic videos there and presentations from Kirsten about the US. And there's so many options. And actually, if we go back to the video that you just watched, I think that really hits the nail on the head. It is bringing together the sport horse industries and the thoroughbred industry. We had Olympic event riders ride at that show at Christmas time. We had Grand National winners, Grand National winning jockeys and horses. And it's all about connecting. You know, we need to connect not only horses with new opportunities, but connect our industries. Here in Ireland, we've been really lucky since Troela started. Eventing Ireland couldn't be more supportive. We're in talks with Show Jumping Ireland and Dressage Ireland about what more we can do. But I think one of the things, you know, that's really important is if we're to look at 20 years down the line, we all have to be on the same page. We have to be working together. I think sometimes the racing industry, especially here in Ireland, it's very much us and them. We don't all kind of see that the horse is a horse and the horse is a horse is a horse. And we're all actually going to fight this, you know, have the same challenges, you know, in the future. If you think about what Anne-Marie Phelps said last week, what Michael said earlier, you know, the younger generations, they're looking at not just horse racing, but the use of animals in sport. And we're not doing anything wrong, but we have to be able to communicate what we're doing. We have to be able to say and defend and, you know, and educate and show people what's involved in our industries and all the good work that we're doing. Ireland is no different to any other country. And it's all about educating and promoting, because there is nothing that we have to be ashamed of. We should be proud of what we're doing because we're doing it well. But again, we just all need to be on the same page.
You've had some strong battles, I know, with traditional racing people. It's really important, I guess, to show them that they're not being judged about the way they've done things in the past, but it can be difficult to convince older generations to kind of change their thinking in some ways. What have you found to be the most successful way to do that?
I suppose I need to say, in Ireland in particular, the people that we have reached out to, we couldn't have had more support. People are beginning to realize that aftercare and welfare, education, it's all so important. It's so important. And that, you know, that mentality is changing. And I really couldn't speak strongly enough about the support that we've got from the Irish industry. I suppose the thing is, they can see what we're doing and they want to come with us. It's not about, you know, telling people what they have to do. It's about showing and leading and educating. And that works. You know, we've seen it now day in, day out, that people are more than happy to come along because they know that it's doing the right thing.
Mm. Natasha, the Hong Kong Jockey Club's obviously very different from many jurisdictions, as we heard from Adrian Farrington, in that, of course, you don't have a breeding industry, so the horses leaving the racing pool do find homes in a very regulated way. And Winfried Engelbrecht Breschers, he's absolutely passionate about this, as you know, we've seen at many international conferences over the years. But what can you see in this model of owners having to sort of provide that retirement fund for their horses to, you know, to make it work in other countries where the numbers of retiring thoroughbreds are far greater? Can you see it being possible for that to work in a similar sort of way, even with the far greater numbers of horses?
I don't see why not. And I think kind of Michael touched on it earlier about, you know, everybody has this shared responsibility from the very start, from the point that the horse is bred. And, you know, if you look at the numbers that Michael touched on earlier, the size of the breeding industry, the size of the racing industry, how much owners are willing to pay for their horses,
it's not unrealistic to think that more contribution could be shared amongst the greater population of people who are involved in the industry as a whole to make it more sustainable. And that's really the key that we're talking about this evening, is about what does racing and what does the industry look like in the future. It has to be sustainable. And one of those huge factors is funding. And that does have to be a shared contribution from everybody that's involved in this sport.
Yeah, Adrian talked about the equestrian and the racing worlds, that, you know, most places traditionally, I guess, they're separate. But in Hong Kong, obviously, the equestrian sports really can't exist, I guess, without the thoroughbreds. And that collaboration is really needed internationally. But what are the things you see in how that system works in Hong Kong that could be adopted by other jurisdictions in future to kind of bring the equestrian and racing worlds closer together?
Yeah, I think, as you mentioned, and as Adrian mentioned earlier in his talk, the equestrian industry in Hong Kong and the racing industry are so closely linked. You know, we couldn't have a sustainable industry without them being so closely linked. Because we don't breed horses in Hong Kong, we are heavily reliant on our retired racehorse, and they do such a fantastic job. You know, as an example, one of our public riding schools could have anywhere up to 50% of their horse population that are teaching people to ride as retired thoroughbred racehorses. That's quite a unique model that's not necessarily replicated that often around the world, but it just shows it can be done. You know, with a bit of time and patience and the right retraining that Adrian mentioned in his talk, each horse has got its field that it can go into in its second career. And I think another important topic is also about the individuality of a horse. You know, you can have a very nice, quiet thoroughbred. You can equally have a very crazy, you know, Irish Connemara or Welsh pony. It's all about individuality of that horse and what is right for it in its second career. And as I said at the start, you know, we have a very close link with the equestrian industry. So I think that stigma that you often hear about, that, you know, retired thoroughbreds can be a little bit crazy or can be a little bit edgy, we don't really have that same kind of stigma here, because from the very start, we're using thoroughbreds in that equestrian industry. And I think that's something that everybody's touched on about, you know, communication, collaboration, and being able to communicate and collaborate on an international scale, not only with different racing jurisdictions, but also with different equestrian bodies and, you know, equestrian associations around the world. That's the way that we'll really help to break those barriers of those stigmas about the thoroughbred and the fact that they are very versatile for a life after racing.
Very well said. And George, I know you're a firm believer that, you know, no racing industry or jurisdiction around the world can kind of blame a lack of funding as an excuse for poor outcomes for thoroughbreds. How can you see over the next 20 years, different ways the money within the racing industry could be used to assist more thoroughbreds in finding longer term homes away from the track? Obviously, Michael has some ideas as well, but what do you think of the main ways we can use this money that, you know, particularly in some countries such as Australia, you know, we're fairly flush with it?
I think it's about all kind of streamlining resources and ensuring that kind of the industry, the takeout from the industry are kind of put to best use. Obviously, Australia's kind of an amazing kind of purple patch in terms of the way the industry there is set up financially, but even for industries like such as the UK back home, where perhaps we don't have such a sustainable financial model, it's about kind of streamlining the processes and trying to really incentivize good practice, I think, within those jurisdictions. Embracing technology, I think, is going to be key. We've quite delayed, in fact, in the UK, just embracing kind of e-passports. And I think that would be a huge step forward in terms of having that traceability for thoroughbreds throughout their life. And I think you can go further if you're going to put more resources, say, into biofilm chips and the avenues that brings in terms of bringing traceability through kind of quality and for industries as a whole, accumulating data pool. I think that'd be a kind of a good use of resources, whatever the kind of the financial structure underpinning that industry is.
Hey, you've obviously worked in the UK, Australia, New Zealand, and you're interested in the bloodstock sales side of the industry. What models would you like to see being adopted in these sorts of countries? I mean, obviously, we're seeing the prize money and sponsorships for thoroughbred equestrian classes, you know, gathering pace, and owners and trainers are more aware of their responsibilities. And again, you know, getting back to some of what Michael said, every sort of section of the racing and breeding industry has a role to play. But, you know, from within the breeding side, a lot of, you know, there are some big breeders, but a lot of people only own, you know, between one and three mares. They don't necessarily make much money out out of them. How do you think you can maybe convince the smaller breeder and the sales companies to take a bit more responsibility?
I think we've got to emphasize the fact that kind of maintaining our social license to operate is a collective effort. And as an industry, we'll be judged by our weakest links. They'll ultimately what make the headline and what kind of the industry's critics can really latch upon when trying to make their argument. So I think it's going to be a collective effort. And the whole concept of kind of cradle to grave care for a horse being kind of really adopted by the industry and kind of thoroughbreds not being seen as a burden in their afterlife, in kind of post-racing careers. So I feel the idea that each stage of the industry has some form of contribution to the overall thoroughbred after their racing career, something we've all benefited towards and we're all kind of huge fans and advocates of. So if we're going to really maintain that in the long term, it's got to be a collective effort. And whether that be levy or registration fees or whatever stage, I think it's got to be seen at every stage upon which kind of a thoroughbred changes hands or is transferred.
Mm. Eleanor, your father was behind the beginnings of the Thoroughbred Aftercare Alliance in America. It's done some great things in the US, but gee, it's a tough gig to get any sort of a cohesion on a national level, you know, in Australia. But you have 50 states, obviously, all with different sorts of ideas. How do you think traceability can be better affected in a huge thoroughbred population such as the US?
Yeah, it's definitely a tough thing to tackle. And I think that the best way to go about it, which has already been lightly mentioned, is through the social licensing. I know that there's been a lot of change within the past 10 years and that this is relatively a new term. But creating a social license tax, I think, would address traceability and funding for our sport and industry, specifically within the United States. Because everyone who's involved in racing, we're passionate about these thoroughbreds, and we are all agreeing to participate in this game, no matter what state you're in. And we all have this responsibility morally and financially to put the thoroughbred first. I think by creating a social license tax for specific participants within our industry would also ensure a solid foundation for the care of our horses, while also holding our industry participants accountable for contributions and also the traceability of our thoroughbreds. We as an industry should want to expand on the work that we've already created, like the likes of the TAA and several other foundations here in the United States for thoroughbred aftercare. And I think one of the first steps to expand is to have a further in-depth knowledge and use of technology for traceability. And that's with, I think, microchips down the road. I know that it's a bit new here in the States, but going forward, I think that'll be very helpful.
Mm, and obviously, you know, there are many licensed people involved in racing, and you know, they have strict rules, particularly in Australia now, about declaring when a horse is transferred or retired. But what would you like to see? You know, we've talked about this quite a bit, the different sort of areas within the industry. What would you like to see owners having to do, whether in the US or globally, within 20 years? How do you see the future of owner responsibility when they buy into a racehorse?
I'm so sorry you cut out. I didn't hear any of that.
That's okay. I was going to say, what is it? How do you see ownership in 20 years? So when someone buys into a racehorse, say in 20 years from now, I imagine it's going to be a different thing. There's going to be much more of a, an expectation or a demand that there is some sort of money that's provided as well for you know, rehab or retraining.
Yeah, I think that, you know, coming in as a new owner, or if you're already an owner having a renewal for your license, that there should be an agreement in order to receive your license that you are in your best effort going to try to ensure that your horses that you are buying are going to be taken care of wherever they are going, whether they're being sold to a different owner within racing or going on to a second career or just overall retirement. I think like having that, again, social license idea behind it and making that agreement is one really important, but you could also tie into it a bit of an educational experience as well. If you are a new owner, part of the licensing requirement is to perhaps watch a video or read some articles about, you know, horses' lifespans and the importance of, you know, having a career past the age of 5, 6, or 7, you know. I think that's something that I would like to see as a young participant within the industry and, you know, potential owner as well.
For sure. And a lot of passion, obviously, in the group speaking today. Caoimhe, we can see everyone, you know, wants to see things being improved, but, you know, everyone is so busy within the racing and the breeding industry around the world. It really falls back on governing bodies in every country, I guess, to affect change. Is it the regulator's responsibility to actually get things done? Do they need to set aside more time and more staff and really make it their priority?
Muted. Sorry, just when Eleanor was speaking there, I'm a little bit on the fence with that. I sometimes think if you just ask people to pay into a pot of money at whatever stage of the horse's life that is, whether that's at, you know, full registration, whether, you know, that's when you get your license, are you absolving yourself of responsibility? And I think that's a really serious question we need to ask ourselves, because right now in Ireland, you know, there is no one in Ireland that is in a position to take in all these horses and make sure that they're cared for the rest of their lives. It's just not feasible, I don't think. But there is a huge role that the governing bodies need to play, whether that's HRI, whether that's the BHA. And I think a lot of it is educational. It's not a case of we're going to tell you exactly what you have to do and you have to do it. But we need to incorporate it into the training licenses, as Eleanor said, when you start your ownership, you know, that's where it needs to be embedded and it needs to come from the ground up. All of a sudden, I think if you start telling people exactly what they have to do and what not to do, you know, it's just not going to work. It's all about bringing people with you and starting from the grassroots. But yes, definitely HRI, the BHA, the Turf Club, all of them, they have a massive role to play.
Tom, it's interesting from a trainer's point of view. If you look at, you know, asking owners to pay more, you know, as Caoimhe was saying, you know, not necessarily, you know, that might not be the right model, but it is a hard thing to do, isn't it? Because a lot of people are just taking a small share here or there, or they own a lot of horses. How do you, as a trainer, think you can sort of address this within an ownership group?
Look, I think it's difficult. Like, I sort of agree with Caoimhe. I think it's difficult to be asking them to put more money in and obviously taking away slight responsibility afterwards. But in this country, we're making headway into responsibility afterwards. And I think things are looking up. There's still a lot of work to be done. But I think in terms of what we do, particularly, obviously, a lot of the time we'll get left with horses from owners, and it'll be our responsibility to find, or as a trainer, responsibility to find a nice home for these horses. And I'm very lucky I have some good avenues for them to be retrained into polo and just sport horses and eventing and even just hack horses. But yeah, it's a difficult situation. You obviously send a lot of horses to the sales, and sometimes you haven't quite got an idea where they end up. You can sort of have a look, but fundamentally it's something that is getting better, and it's a hell of a lot better than it was 10 years ago, but it still is a lot of improvement to be done, I'd say.
Yeah, and in particular, having spent time here in Australia, I mean, we see, you know, it's not so much the horses from the big stables, you know, in Sydney or Melbourne or so forth. They tend to go to the smaller stables out in the country or right up in, you know, the north or the far west of Australia. And that's the trouble, isn't it, to really get the some of the smaller, more rural trainers, you know, to have the responsibility, because, you know, they can't be hanging on to all these horses that they wind up training either.
Well, that's it. We breed a lot of horses in this country, and actually we're a lot of our horses are ending up going abroad. And from the owner's perspective, I think they quite like the fact that they're going to the sales and going to race in another jurisdiction. But beyond the walls of the English industry, I wouldn't know what happens to them. Obviously, we do our best. I do my best personally as a trainer, and I'm sure every trainer in this country would say the same, to try and rehome these horses, but it's difficult to actually know exactly where they end up. We're all obviously trying to make sure they go to the best home possible, but it doesn't always work out that way. I think the BHA are making roads into it. I mean, they're making it responsible for horses that have been retired. They make sure they get contact details of the new ownership. Beyond that, I couldn't tell you what happens, but it's starting to look that way. And I think obviously the ROR is a great initiative that seems to be going really well. And obviously that's being well funded and good money on offer for these sort of horses. And I think people are really taking note of that. And it's only going to be a small pot of horses that end up in that situation, but it's a good start. And I'm hoping that will sort of expand in the future.
For sure. And I guess, you know, for the whole panel, just a general question, where do you see the industry in 20 years as far as looking at you know, really looking after all our thoroughbreds? What's your kind of call to action so that the racing industry is safe in this ever-changing world and you know, we can actually look after the thoroughbreds? Any of you want to have an overall sort of thought?
I think it's been touched on in some of the earlier talks, and just following off the back of what Tommy was saying, really firming up, you know, international collaboration and not necessarily just informal. You know, like Jen was saying in her talk, that if Hong Kong horses end up under her watch in Australia, you know, she'll let us know and send us an email. They're the kind of collaborations and partnerships we need to really be formalizing. You know, it's not out of the realms of possibility as well that could be expanded to the equestrian industry. You know, if you have a horse entered into dressage, show jumping, eventing, whatever, the technology would be available to flag that horse is a retired horse. Where has it come from? You know, there are databases that could be created between racing, not only just between different countries, but also between equestrian. So I think there really needs to be a greater international collaboration. And that would be my point on the call to action.
And I think on that, Tash is 100% right. And it goes back to the promotion, anything that we can do to make the promotion of our sport and the care that they get throughout racing and after racing, it's not going to do anything but help. And it's so important to have those international relations and be proud of what we're doing and be proud of those horses who retire and go on to even better things than they ever did on the track.
Any other thoughts there? I think probably we're pretty much covering everything, aren't we? Yeah. Sorry, Michael.
Sorry. I think 20 years from now, Carolyn, I think culturally, it needs to be implicit that the metric, I'm a racehorse owner, one of the metrics of success, arguably the most important metric of success for me as a racehorse owner, is how my horse transitions. And that is an enduring metric of success. So when you buy, the day you buy a horse, you should be front of mind that I'm responsible for transitioning this horse. It's just a cultural shift that starts now.
And Tom, as you said, you touched on with your horses in the UK, obviously it's a huge equestrian population to see them go into whether it be polo or you know, eventing, dressage, show jumping, whatever. But there's so much joy. I'm sure you've seen it with some of your owners when you see a horse, and I know I've seen it with my horses, when they actually go and compete, it's as exciting, if not almost more so, because you're proud that you've actually given them, these horses, a good chance at a new life. But the owners get a real buzz out of it too, don't they?
Completely agree. Yeah. I mean, look, these horses have got, thoroughbreds have got great brains and they're very, very retrainable, which is huge. From my angle, from that perspective, I mean, I've got some horses that have gone on to be very good at polo, who've got sort of quite high goal, which is fantastic. And it's nice for owners to be able to see these and obviously eventing stuff. It's great. But it's, it's one thing to keep an eye on. And I think, that, like I say, the thoroughbreds just have such a great nature and brain, but fundamentally it has to come down to our responsibility at the start of their riding career, because we are fundamentally where it all starts. We break the horses in, we train them for the first, depending how many years you have them, 2 or 3 years, and we have to make sure that the riders are suitable for the horses, even in the mornings on the gallops, to make sure these horses don't suddenly become uncontrollable or have issues. So we have to make sure it's our responsibility as trainers that these horses are well looked after the whole way through their career with us. And that'll then help when they come to going on to do something else afterwards.
Most definitely. Well, I think that probably pretty much wraps up the panel of our young professionals. Thanks to you all. And stick around. We do have some questions that have come in now as we get towards the end of the session. But Michael, it's good you just sort of jumped in there again, because the first question is to you. And I sort of know the answer to a degree, because I know, obviously, you know, people are worried if you charge racehorse owners more for a retirement fund, people think they might, you know, decide not to buy into racehorses. But the question is, why are racehorse owners not required to deposit a financial sum to be held by the industry until the horse has found a comfortable home or new career? It should not be possible to simply disassociate from your horse. If this were to be the case, the sum would be forfeited and put towards welfare. This could be a condition of ownership registration. But the basic question there is, you know, why have we not actually really put this in place yet, as far as, you know, getting owners to be, you know, putting a sum in towards the retirement?
I don't have the answer for that. I mean, I'm really inspired by the Hong Kong Jockey Club experience. There's no reason. The money's there. There's no reason why we shouldn't do it. I think it's just, you know, there hasn't been enough pressure up until now. And I think that there's no good reason. I can't find a reason for it. I mean, there are many people who take full responsible de facto, Carolyn, they take full responsibility for their horses. But I think particularly the syndicators, where you've got, as you're alluding to before, where there's 30 or 40 different owners in a horse, who actually takes the responsibility when the horse is retired? I think it needs to be, does it need to be $16,000? I don't know. But we go back to the shared responsibility model, that if there's a contribution from the standing provider, there's a contribution from the mayor, the owner of the mayor, and then there's a contribution from the racehorse owner, you'll get to the required amount. But I think, as what I alluded to before in my talk, I do believe, importantly, that every aspect of the industry needs to be revisited and looked at through that lens. Whether you're a breaker, I like what the speaker said before, we need to think about everything we do, how that will impact the horse's success at repurposing. And I think we could to look at everything in a different lens, through that lens, I think.
Indeed. And Kirsten, a question here for you. Whether it is restricted to horses sold through an auction or open to people that already have really, you know, shown their love for the thoroughbred and taken them on. And the question here is, why is the thoroughbred makeover limited to recently retired horses? I guess it is great to get them straight off the track and give them that initial training. Is that the main reason?
Yeah, we identify the horses that are coming off the track as, by volume, the population that is in need of the greatest service. Horses that are well established in their post-track careers are accounted for. They don't have a transition that needs to be facilitated. And there's also already plenty of programs in existence that incentivize and reward horses, people that are choosing to ride off-track thoroughbreds, whether in thoroughbred-specific shows or in open competition. The Thoroughbred Incentive Program is a great example of that. But we've decided to focus the effort of the makeover specifically on horses that are ready to exit the racing industry.
And do many of them stay with the people that actually buy them and train them up? I mean, how many of them actually stay with the participants, and how many are actually on sold?
So we typically, we offer the marketplace towards the end of the summer as we're getting ready to go into the actual event portion. We go through a final paperwork process, and people who do need to move their horses on are offered the opportunity to include their horse in the ASPCA makeover marketplace. That is a service that we offer at a nominal fee for people that do need to find homes for their horses. We're not party to the transaction. It's not an auction. It's not a guaranteed sale. People are open to negotiate price and pick the home that they feel is most appropriate for the horse. They pick their own prices. We're just simply there to facilitate and try to help with the marketing and bring in shoppers. So we have that catalog that I mentioned where we send that out in the mail for free to anybody that wants a copy. We have the digital version online, do extensive marketing, making sure that each horse gets shared on social media in advance of the event. And then at the event itself, horses are identified throughout as being for sale. So they have little icons like next to their name on the entry list and the results on their competition number. And we have a dedicated trial arena where shoppers can independently set up a time to try horses on site. We have Haggard Equine Medical Institute that is on call to help facilitate pre-purchase exams. So we do a lot to try to help make sure that if somebody does need to move their horse on, which we are in support of, that they have the support to do so. We typically see maybe about 40% or so of horses that make it to Kentucky are entered into that marketplace. So it usually ends up being maybe 120, 150 horses that are available for sale. We have a lot of people who are repeat makeover participants who use the makeover and integrate it into their business model of reselling horses, which we think is great, and they are great partners. And we do our best to keep track of that data as far as what homes those horses are transitioning to and at what price and so on.
Mm-hmm. Oh, interesting. And Adrian, just an interesting, was touched on in the previous session as far as that one last race and trying to encourage people to maybe make a decision to retire a horse, you know, wherever they're racing around the world, rather than just have that, oh, maybe one last chance. What difference do you really see it makes? I mean, you have so much sort of data there within the Hong Kong sort of population of thoroughbreds. How much difference can it really make to the number of horses that are going to retire potentially more sound than if they had that last race?
Yeah, it's a good question. And I think ultimately time will tell. But in terms of rehabilitating injuries, if we haven't advanced to more serious degenerative joint disease, for example, we can keep the horse's mobility and movement much more supple. We can make them a much more athletic horse within their second career. I think the question regarding data, we track and we have been tracking for the last few years how the condition is of the horses when they retire will come through our assessments. And it's something that we're lining up, hopefully, to do a formal research project on in the future to actually look at the outcomes for these horses and the condition they are in when they retire.
Yeah, very good. And just one last question. Jen Hughes, you know, obviously we in Australia, a lot of the funding for the regulatory bodies and their retraining programs or off-track programs comes from a percentage of prize money. But someone's actually asked, how is the Racing Victoria program funded?
Yeah, so 2% of prize money in Victoria goes towards equine welfare as a whole. And that's actually topped up by our Industry Sustainability Fund and also Racing Victoria's Operational Fund. And that's what contributes to, when I spoke about the accelerated post-racing and traceability initiatives, that was as a result of a commitment of $25 million over the course of 3 years. And that's as we're actually coming to the end of that funding at the end of 2022. And we'll be looking to be reporting on how that's been spent. But the target was for these post-racing initiatives.
I see. An interesting one here as well. Adrian, do you have alternative partner farms overseas in addition to the New Zealand options or the New Zealand farm or system to which you can export these horses? I know a lot go to individual properties that do take these horses in, but do you have specific, you know, farms that you have an actual sort of setup with where you send a whole bunch of horses?
Yeah, that's also it's a really good question. And as a club, we're continually looking for options as to rehome horses in for a second career. And we have quite an exciting project that is upcoming. It's been a little bit delayed because of the pandemic affecting everyone globally, but that is working with a partner farm, Yulong, which is in Shuozhou, County Shaanxi province in mainland China. And there's a really quite smart setup there, and our chief mainland veterinary advisor has been working with them to develop facilities. And we hope to be sending a trial group of horses there quite soon, once we can move horses and people freely across the border. And that's something that we would have jockey club teams involved in throughout as well. And we're in the process of contracting a team of mainland professional veterinarians who could help us monitor and track the horses as they move out into second home, so that we can ensure we match the horses to stables that will ensure their ongoing care for all the horses that we send them. So that's an upcoming project. But yes, we're always looking for alternatives.
Natasha, obviously, you know, there's you know, there are better methods, as Tom touched on a little earlier. As far as the way horses are trained, the way they're it was brought up earlier too, as far as the way, you know, the whether it be the weaning process or the handling of horses early on to really affect their outcomes once they are off the track. I mean, what do you think we should be doing, or the industry should be doing, you know, around the world to be really trying to, you know, get those horses so that, or get trainers and pre-trainers and breakers to really understand more the impact that can have on the rest of that thoroughbred's life?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think Adrian touched on it earlier, and so did Jen in both of their presentations, about looking at how you categorise horses. And I think that assessment process is really important. And that assessment process is really important from day one. You know, if that horse, from the moment that it's brought into the world until it being a yearling, to enter training and going through its life, if I go back to that international collaboration and sharing of information, if throughout its life that horse carried a bank of information about its temperament, about its way of going, about its veterinary history, that would really help on a global scale of informing future owners, you know, informing the next trainer that horse is going to, informing the person who's taking that horse on as a second career, is really looking at that sharing of information and how that horse is assessed. And I know there's a lot of global standards about assessment, and both Jen and Adrian have touched on them. But once that horse has probably left racing and got into that equestrian field, that kind of formal assessment then is, of course, down to the different types of equestrian activity they do or different types of vets. And it might be, you know, a really good idea in the future that something could really be standardized and formalized, which would make all the data that's available very easy to read and easy to understand from everybody that's in that horse's life throughout that whole process.
Yeah, very good. And just there is one more question here, Jen Hughes, about the actual promotion of the thoroughbred and you know, what a great breed it is, because obviously in Australia, very similar to in the US as well and other places, where, you know, the thoroughbred was the go-to horse for many years till about the 80s. The warm bloods and other breeds came in and became the go-to horse for a lot of people with their equestrian pursuits. But how important is it to really be talking up the merits of the thoroughbred, the versatility, the athleticism? I mean, they are the supreme athlete, as opposed to the other breeds, really talking people into getting back to the thoroughbred?
I think it's important, but it's only one piece of the puzzle for us. We talk about the demand for those, in particular, we're talking about those category A horses when we talk about promoting the versatility of the thoroughbred. And sort of, as I alluded to, that's not our key focus. We've had a successful sponsorship of events program for the last 10 years, and we continue to build on that. And it has been our bread and butter, so it's integral, but it's not our focus right now. We're trying to focus on those sort of the more niche elements. Where can we place these slightly less desirable horses? And that's probably our key focus just now.
All right. Well, I think that pretty much wraps things up. We're not far off almost the 2-hour mark. So I think thank you all at the panel, the young professionals and our four speakers as well. It's been fascinating to hear all the different thoughts from around the world. And I'll just hand over now to IFAR's Elliot Forbes to say some final thank yous before we wrap up.
Thank you very much, Caroline. Ladies and gentlemen, what a powerful and illuminating session. If we're in the same right room, I know that you would have given this panel of young professionals and speakers a rousing round of applause. It has been an absolute pleasure to have your company for the 2022 edition of the IFAR conference. We're very proud of the fact that this is the 6th IFAR forum and that we've taken these messages around the world, from Washington to Seoul to Oslo and to Cape Town. And then when the pandemic hit us, now in 2 virtual forums. And on every occasion we've got together, one of the major racing nations has been rocked by a media scandal involving the welfare of retired racing animals or some other animal welfare topic. In week one, BHA chair Anna Marie Phelps reminded us of the recent scrutiny in the UK and challenged us all of the need to rethink our industry operating model. Her message was very direct. Society's expectations of our industry mean that our duty of care does not end when our horses leave the racetrack. Traceability, meaningful post-racing careers, open, transparent accountability of our industry data and practices are the new norm. And one of the statements that particularly resonated with me was, society can and will use aftercare as a window into the soul of racing. This should be a sobering proposition for any racing administrator, participant, or owner. Aftercare cannot be an afterthought. It is now front and centre. And it was clearly front and centre when we learnt about the tremendous research work that Dr. Meredith Flash is undertaking in Australia. If we can't answer the question, what happens to our horses, then who can? And in the same vein, Angela Schuster's address on traceability demonstrated that we have many important elements in place already to deliver traceability, but there are some aspects that do require more focus. Fortunately, we don't need to reinvent the wheel, but we can learn from best practice in the livestock industry and adapt those practices to suit our own industry. Dr. Jeff Burke provided a compelling overview of the very considered and scientific basis for making responsible end-of-life decisions. As a veterinarian, I know from first-hand experience that these are not easy decisions, but we cannot back away from these responsibilities, and approaching the issue in a science-based and compassionate manner is the appropriate and responsible response. And without a doubt, a key highlight from our first week was the wonderful presentation from Jock Hutchinson, direct from the Scottish Highlands, who showed us the true magic of the human-horse bond and how this can literally turn lives around. Today was very intriguing to hear about the thoughts of the true sustainability advocate, Michael Drapek. He reminded us to look at things through the lens of beyond the track and truly challenged us to say, who is listening? Jen Hughes from Race Victoria has provided us with a very clear indication as to the high watermark for off-the-track programs. Race Victoria has been a leader in this field for many years, and under Jen's highly professional guidance, she's continued to raise the bar year after year. Most importantly, I know that Jen is motivated by a deep felt passion for her work and shares her knowledge and insights freely, knowing that true success relies on sharing knowledge and building industry-wide capability. Kirsten Green's presentation on the versatility of the thoroughbred was an exemplar of our conference theme, Many Paths, One Goal. I was fortunate to attend the thoroughbred makeover a few years ago, and it is truly one of the most inspiring events I've ever attended. Thoroughbreds are versatile, highly intelligent, and suited to many jobs. And when horses have jobs, they are well cared for. Learning about the Hong Kong Jockey Club's retirement assessment process from Dr. Adrian Farrington was particularly insightful. Codifying our best industry practices is not only important to deliver consistency, but it also allows us to share best practice and to demonstrate best practice to our critics. And finally, I was personally delighted to hear firsthand about the knowledge and the depth of thinking that our next generation of industry leaders have demonstrated today. The decisions that we make today will shape the industry of tomorrow, the industry that this generation of young professionals will inherit. They know the world has changed and that a sustainable industry will be one that is responsive, transparent, and compassionate. And listening to our panel today certainly gave me confidence that our industry is in safe hands. On behalf of the IFAR committee, I would like to thank all of our speakers from today's forum and from week one. Your insights and your wisdom will help us to set the agenda as we continue to build the case for change. I would also like to acknowledge the support of the Japan Racing Association, whose generous sponsorship has enabled us to bring you this 22 edition of the IFAR conference. I'd also like to extend my sincere thanks to our moderators, Caroline Searcy and Rishi Prasad, who have given up their time and guided us through these important discussions. To the IFAR team behind the scenes, thank you for your hard work, and in particular, to very hardworking individuals, Tony Vaughan from the Retraining of Racehorses UK and Alexa Rabbit from the US Jockey Club. Our IFAR forums would not be possible without your hard work and dedication. And finally, I would like to thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for taking the time out of your busy schedules to turn your minds to this very important topic of aftercare. Your undivided attention demonstrates in no uncertain terms that through the window of aftercare, the soul of racing is alert, striving to improve, and above all, is compassionate. Thank you very much, Carolyn.
Thank you very much for your support too, and the entire steering committee of IFAR. And thanks to everyone for watching the last or the two sessions for 2022. Don't forget, if you missed any part of either conference, they can both be found in coming days on the IFAR website. And make sure you follow IFAR News on social media and join the subscription list to receive the biannual newsletter to know everything that's happening around the world. So let's hope the food for thought from these two conference sessions in 2022 becomes a five-course meal of action for the benefit of our thoroughbreds and our racing and breeding industry right around the world. I look forward to seeing you all again soon.
I just want to be someone. I just want to be someone. Dive and disappear without a trace. I just want to be someone. Well, doesn't everyone? And if you feel the great dividing, I want to be the one you're guiding. Cause I believe someone, oh, I want to be somebody to someone, oh, I never had nobody and no road home, I want to be somebody to someone. And if the sun starts setting, the sky goes cold, and if the clouds get heavy and start to fall, I really need somebody to call my own. I want to be somebody to someone. Someone to you, someone to you, someone, oh, I never had nobody and no road home. I wanna be somebody to someone.